So the second phase that we are seeing in the privatization kind of a shift or trend is the water sector reforms. These are primarily, you know, the reform and restructuring projects funded by the international financial institutions, primarily World Bank and ADB in several states, including Andhra Pradesh, UP, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh, Punjab, and many others. And these are basically now the forming the platform for launching the large scale reforms in, you know, in legislation, in financial restructuring, in administrative restructuring, institutional restructuring, those kind of aspects these reforms projects are bringing. Like yesterday we were discussing about the Maharashtra MWRRA case. So MWRRA is a legislation which was not brought by the government of Maharashtra on its own. It was actually a conditionality in the World Bank reforms and restructuring loan which the government of Maharashtra signed and, you know, agreed on. And the similar case is with Madhya Pradesh. Madhya Pradesh recently brought water regulatory authority legislation into the state, and that is also a conditionality in the World Bank project which the state had signed. So these water sector reforms are looking to, you know, deeply ingrain commercialization and privatization into the water sector. And then we have the third phase, especially after the JNNURM and UIDSSMT launched by the central government, that was in 2005. So we have PPPs, especially in urban sectors, where public-private partnerships are, you know, supposed to be encouraged to, you know, by the local bodies to get funds from the central government for urban renewal programs. And these are, you know, we have cases in Tirupur, in Nagpur, in Khandwa, in Delhi, and several other places where, you know, PPPs are under implementation or being proposed in urban water supply. Now, we'll briefly have a look at the genesis, how this all began. So, pre-1991, what was the modus operandi of the World Bank and the ADB? They had mainly the kind of lending from these financial institutions was project-based lending, essentially for irrigation projects, dams, and water supply. Like Sardar Sarovar, Subarnarekha, Periyar, Mahanadi, Godavari, etc. Upper Indravati and Koyana. And water supply and sewage projects, these were specific projects in Punjab, Uttar Pradesh, Maharashtra, Gujarat and other states. There was a shift after 1991, as briefly discussed yesterday about the LPG policies, the major shift in, you know, the approach by the World Bank and other financial institutions. This change from project-based lending to sector loans covering the whole sector, and this was also the beginning of the transformation of the whole economy, and we were seeing policy interference by these international financial institutions into the domestic policies of the governments. Let's have a look at the post 1991 World Bank loans that have been given in India. So we have water sector consolidation loans in states like Orissa, Tamil Nadu, Haryana in early 1990s. And then in early 2000, we had the water sector restructuring loans. These are primarily reform loans for states like Uttar Pradesh, Rajasthan, Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, you know, to push full-blown reforms in the water sector, comprising legislations, institutional restructuring, operational changes, and other aspects. And then loans from the World Bank also came for urban reforms scheme like JNNURM, and There was also an increasing push for making fundamental policy and structural changes in the whole sector. And especially a push for much bigger role to the private companies. We'll have a look at the international trends, what was happening internationally in other countries. There were parallel trends internationally of privatization. There was a lot of hype which came along with these private projects in places like Bolivia, in Argentina, in Philippines, where they were, you know, portrayed as the solution to water sector problems. There were attempts to push private projects in large dams and hydropower, attempts to privatize urban water supply in many important cities. There was outright privatization in hydro projects. In India, if you see in Maheshwar project, which is on the Narmada, in Malaysia it was Bakun, in Chile it was BOBO, in Uganda it was Bujagali, and then Laos we had Nam Thuen. It's not actually what we call PPP, it's different from PPP. So you have a private company coming in and, you know, bidding for a certain kind of a project. It could be a hydropower or a urban water supply project, and taking up a contract. It's not a tendering, it's different from a tendering process.
So there are different ways it is structured. So it can be a design, build, own, operate contract. So most of them are BOOT. So you have build, own, operate. So you actually build it, you build the project, you bring in all your money, and you bring in all the investment, and maybe at the end of some 30, 35 years, depending upon the contract, transfer that back to the public. But till then, you're the owners and you run it completely. Yes. Now, yeah, mostly private. Initially, only public, because there were only public utilities. Now, it is being sold. Either it can be a merchant plant, so it can sell directly to anybody, or it can sell to the power trading exchanges. So there has been a lot of development. It's become quite complicated over the last 15 years. But when initially it was there, the power was only to be sold to the public utilities.
It's without invitation or tendering kind of a process.
It can also be with a tendering process. But
generally we have seen...
mostly it has been through an MOU route, but it can be with a tendering process. But by outright privatization, the idea is that they just own it sort of outright or take over the project outright. It can be a new old project which is leased out or sold out, or it can be a fresh project, greenfield project, which is then all the investment is brought in, and so that's the sort of outright privatization. And the others would be, more like a public-private partnership where the government also puts in some money, and which is typically what is now happening everywhere. See, I think initially the primary sort of justification or drivers were twofold of privatization processes. One is that the government or the public public sector has very few resources to bring in new investments. So that was one of the prime drivers. And of course the argument that private sector is more efficient. When the resources was a big prime driver, that time you had this outright privatization, because it was expected that they will just come in with all their money, that they have this bag full of money which they will bring in. And that's why initial phase, not just in India but globally, what you see is this outright privatization. Of course that rapidly failed because the private sector really didn't bring in that much money. So that's another big part of the discussion. We won't maybe get into it right
also
now.
Also because of what Sripad said, adding to his point, also because of the policy prescriptions of the international financial agencies. Especially in cases of the Latin American countries where privatization happened in the early 1990s. It was outright privatization but pushed because of the World Bank or IMF conditionalities.
Yeah, but usually because the states had gone bankrupt or broke or had... So they didn't have the money to do PPPs at that time. Now the economies in those countries have grown, now they can bring in the money to underwrite the risk or whatever.
Well, I think that's not the main reason. The reason is, I think the private sector did not bring in the investment that they wanted.
That's true.
And again, I think our understanding is that they will not, because the fundamental contradiction which is there.
Yeah.
So anyway,
we
are trying to talk about privatization and commodification. So even if it is controlled by a government-owned corporate entity, or by the government, but it is operating in a market-based principle, then it has certain implications.
So in some sense, would you agree it's the worst of both worlds?
Yes.
Bankers will follow the logic of the market, nor does it follow the government's original purpose of equity.
Yes. I would say that that would be a case of having worst of both worlds.